Hey, what's going on? This video is about stick and rudder fundamentals and how to apply them to get the P-47 down safely in DCS utilising a World War II style run and brake. Before we start, if you haven't watched Reflected's video on how to fly the brake in a Spitfire, I highly recommend it. For most people it'll probably be enough, but if you want to see it step through in detail and learn a bit more about flying fundamentals, this is the video for you. In the interest of transparency, my aviation background is in gliding and tailwheel aircraft. So while I feel comfortable talking about stick and rudder work, I am not a real-life P-47 pilot. That aside, let's get into it. The first concept we'll introduce is called attitude flying. If you Google attitude flying, you'll see something like attitude plus power equals performance. What does that mean for us, though? It means that for a desired performance, i.e. a straight and level cruise, that there's a corresponding nose attitude and power setting that will give you that performance every time. With practice, it's an incredibly accurate way of flying that maximizes situational awareness. And it's also the way that these old warbirds are meant to be flown. One of the easiest ways to spot someone who plays a lot of flight sim is that their head will be buried in the instrument panel in a real aircraft, even on a clear summer's day. Now, there's a natural delay between the aircraft's performance and what the gauges will show. If you look at a cutout of a real plane and see how the rating has to travel from the pitot tubes in the wing and the fuselage to the cockpit, you'll see exactly why. For this reason, people who fly like this without good attitude fundamentals tend to always be behind the aircraft, and they spend a lot of time chasing instruments, which leads to sloppy flying, which we want to avoid. Let's take straight and level flight, for instance. Our attitude is the straight and level flying attitude, which, at the default seat height, sees the horizon intersect the center of the gun sight. Our power setting is 32 inches of manifold pressure at 2250 RPM. We'll set the power, hold the attitude, allow the speed to settle, and then trim the aircraft out. When we trim, we use the acronym EAR, Elevator, Aileron, Rudder, to dictate the order in which we trim the aircraft out. Then we'll take a good look out for any 109s trying to bounce us, and then we glance at the instruments to see if we need to make any corrections. And what do you know, we're flying bang on straight and level. And we did it mostly by looking outside the aircraft. Combining this with a lookout should mean that you spend 80% of your time looking outside of the cockpit. This fundamental has kept pilots alive since the days of the Sopwith Camel, and most reputable flying schools will teach you something similar even now. With that aside, let's look at the maneuver we're going to be flying. Please excuse my 2005 level PowerPoint art. The brake begins with the initial, which should see you at 100 feet AGL, 300 miles per hour on the dead side of the runway, i.e. the side away from where the traffic is turning. A good power setting to use is 42 inches of manifold pressure at 2550 RPM with the straight and level flight attitude. Once established on the initial, we conduct our entry checks for the brake. Our brake entry checks are checking that the CSU is set to auto, RPMs at 2550, mixture is auto rich, intercooler on all shutters are neutral, cow flaps are in, which we can check visually, and the throttle boost interconnect is off. Once you're at the end of the runway, you commence the brake, still at 300 miles per hour at 100 feet AGL. To do that, you conduct a thorough lookout, looking right, in front, above, and left all the way downwind for a left-hand brake. Move the throttle to idle and conduct a climbing turn to downwind, utilizing 60 to 90 degrees angle of bank, which should take you to 1,000 feet AGL. It would then be established on downwind at 150 to 160 miles per hour at 100 feet AGL, aiming to have your wingtip touching the edge of the runway to achieve the correct spacing. As you roll into downwind, open the canopy, travel the gear once you're below 200 miles per hour, check the hydraulic system is back to 1000 PSI once you see the green light illuminate, and then physically confirm that the tail wheel is locked. It's worth pointing out that even though the brake in a downwind looks like a racetrack circuit in the PowerPoint diagram, it's actually more like a continuous turn from the brake into your base leg at the end. You probably won't spend much time straight and level at all. Once you're beyond the runway threshold, maintaining 150 miles per hour at 800 to 1000 feet AGL with your correct spacing, you then commence your turn onto what's called the base leg of your circuit. You initiate this with a thorough lookout, looking right, in front, and left all the way down the runway, and then rolling smoothly to 30 degrees angle of bank, to keeping a level attitude. Once on the base turn, we use our nose attitude to control airspeed and the throttle for rate of descent. As we track through mid-base at about 500 feet, we travel the flaps to full. This turn will continue right until you're over the runway threshold, rolling wings level at 115 to 120 miles per hour right over the numbers. As you descend to just above the runway, smoothly reduce power to idle and hold off the aircraft at level flight just above the runway until it begins to want to sink. Because the P-47 is such a heavy aircraft in DCS, you'll find that at 115 to 120 miles per hour, that you won't have much of a hold off at all. The next phase of landing is the round out. As you feel the aircraft begin to descend, smoothly move the nose to the 3-point attitude, which looks like this, with the horizon intersecting just below the top of the instrument panel at the third rivet. And once you've achieved that attitude, you hold it until you touch down. This is often referred to as a full stall landing, because the 3-point attitude is also the stall attitude for most aircraft, and so a well-executed 3-pointer will see you stall just as you touch down. Once you're on the ground, pull the stick into your stomach, return the flaps to the up position, open the cowl flaps, and unlock the tail wheel once you're slow enough to taxi off the runway. The P-47 is a very forgiving aircraft on the ground thanks to its wide undercarriage, but all tailwheel aircraft require you to pay attention until the engine is off. This is because the center of gravity sits behind the main wheels, which means that the tail will always want to swing in front of the mains, which means that you need to be paying attention and always feeding in rudder to keep it straight. Now let's put it all together. With the aircraft correctly configured, we begin our entry checks for the brake. We check that the CSU is in the up position, that our RPM is at 2550, mixture is set to auto rich, oil and intercooler shutters are neutral, visually check that the cowl flaps are in, and then ensure that the throttle interconnect is off with the boost lever fully rearward. As we approach the end of the runway in conflicting traffic, we conduct our lookout, reduce the power smoothly to idle, and commence the brake. Notice how the nose tracks in an arc over the horizon before we allow it to settle, simultaneously reducing the angle of bank to intercept the correct spacing. As a safety point, you should always be looking into your turns as well. We open the canopy, check our airspeed, and allow the landing gear to travel. As the gear travels, we feed in power to arrest the rate of descent, and allow the nose to rise until the engine cowling touches the horizon. Keep checking the wingtip to adjust the spacing as required. Once the landing gear is locked, we glance at the hydraulic pressure and physically check the tailwheel locking mechanism. The next event is the base turn. We look right, in front, above and left down the runway for conflicting traffic and smoothly roll to a 30 degree level turn with the horizon going through the center of the gun sight. At 20 to 25 inches of manifold pressure, that produces a 1000 foot rate of descent. We can draw the sink rate with the power and lower the nose as required to maintain 150. As we enter our final approach with the last 90 degrees of the turn, we allow the speed to decay to 120 to 125, enabling us to cross the threshold at 115 to 120. Keep a good lookout for any conflicting traffic as you do this. The work cycle now is aspect, aimpoint, and airspeed. Aspect refers to the angle of your approach controlled with the throttle, your aimpoint should be the numbers, and your airspeed is controlled with the nose and should be kept at 120 to 125. Slowing to 115 over the threshold. Roll wings level over the numbers and reduce the power smoothly to idle. Slightly raise the nose to the 3-point attitude as the aircraft sinks and hold it there. Now pull the stick fully rear, raise your flaps and open the cowl flaps. Post-landing administration is generally conducted once clear of the runway, but in the interest of video length, we'll conduct them during the rollout. Unlock the tailwheel once you're slow enough to taxi off, and there you have it. A World War II style run and brake in the P-47 Thunderbolt in DCS. We'll finish with some discussion on the common faults and how to correct them. The first error, which appears fairly frequently, is flaring too high above the runway. There's a school of thought out there that flaring too high is better than flaring too low, as flaring too low will generally always result in a bounce, whereas flaring high at least means that the aircraft will have stalled prior to landing. Misjudging the flare height by a few feet is fairly routine and can still be considered a safe landing. Flaring as high as 10 feet or more, however, is a very unsafe practice that can get you and the aircraft written off. A lot of tailwheel aircraft have a very nasty tendency of dropping a wing in a stall, and a big heavy fighter like the P-47 was no exception to this. There are two points which may help. The first, use your peripherals on either side of the nose to judge your height. Remember what the 3-point attitude looks like on the ground and use that as a reference point. Having a good memory of where the horizon should be intersecting the instrument panel is crucial. 2. If you realize that you're high, feed in some power to control the rate of descent. This is going to lengthen your ground roll, but it's a far safer practice than risking an uncontrolled stall onto the runway. The second error is flaring too low. There are a few great methods of addressing this, but the method that most people find helpful is to think about flying the aircraft for as long as possible once you enter the hold-off. If you get yourself into the mindset of wanting to fly the aircraft just above the runway until it will fly no more, you'll generally always achieve the three-point attitude without even trying, and you'll do so just on the edge of the aircraft's stall speed. Now, bouncing is a very routine part of flying a tailwheel aircraft. For a small bounce, simply hold the three-point attitude and the aircraft will naturally settle back onto the runway. For a large bounce, the safest practice is to smoothly add power, raise your gear and flaps, and conduct a go-around. While the landing may sometimes be salvageable, there is a very real risk of stalling the aircraft high above the runway after the speed's bled off from the bounce. As we spoke about before with flaring too high, this is a massive safety breach and can very easily ruin both yourself and the aircraft. Now, that brings us to the end of the video. Hopefully you've learned something from this, or at the very least, you found it entertaining. If stick and rudder work and flying fundamentals are something that you found interesting after watching this video, I cannot recommend gliding enough. The long wings cause a ton of adverse yaw that demand a lot of rudder coordination to counteract, and the lack of an engine means that they can virtually only be flown by attitudes. Even a mediocre glider pilot is generally an above average stick and rudder operator compared to somebody who's only flown nose wheel Cessnas. Best of all, it's also extremely cheap compared to powered flying. I hope you've enjoyed this video and I welcome all of your feedback, positive and negative. Thanks for watching.